Hello, everyone. My name is Jenna Jacobs. I am the Director of Development at the Paul Taylor Dance Foundation. I'm here with Artistic Director Michael Novak. I want to welcome you all joining us this evening to Community Day, Designing Taylor. Thank you for wrapping up your weekend with us. Before we start, I just want to take a moment to thank the Board of Directors and Board of Advisors of the Paul Taylor Dance Foundation for their incredible support and guidance, especially throughout the past year. And in addition, I'd like to express our ongoing appreciation to the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs for making public programs like this possible. Despite the challenges of the past year, the DCA has been a continual advocate and supporter of the arts in New York City, and we are deeply grateful to them. If you can join in the effort to fortify our company, I hope you will go to ptamd.org/donate and chip in whatever you can to help sustain our organization, and so that we can continue to provide opportunities like this one to you. That's ptamd.org/donate. PTAMD stands for Paul Taylor American Modern Dance. A gift of any size is always welcome, a vote of confidence for our dancers, and helps us remain connected to you until we can be back in the theater. Lastly, although, as always, we'd rather welcome you into our Lower East Side studios in person, we are proud to offer this dynamic discussion with Michael Novak and Tony Award-winning costume designer William Ivey Long, and to show Mr. Taylor's penultimate dance, The Open Door. So with that, I'm headed to the live chat. Hope you'll join me there. So it's my pleasure to introduce Artistic Director Michael Novak, who can provide some more insight into what you'll see this evening. Hi, Michael.
Hi, Jenna. Thank you so much. And thank you to all of you for taking the time to join us this evening. Tonight, we are proud to host our fifth Community Day and our first installment of our newest series, Designing Taylor. An opportunity for you to gain unique insights from the designers who worked alongside and collaborated with Paul Taylor. Where there is a dance maker, there is a team of visual artists, set designers, costume designers, and lighting designers that work masterfully to bring a vision to life. This new series will honor these important relationships. Now, please know we deeply believe that the only way to truly understand and experience the brilliance and magnitude of Paul Taylor's dances is live and in the theater. But in response to these times, we are pleased to continue to create opportunities to engage with you, dialogue as a community, and share stories, stories that you might not normally get to hear. So a few things to remember. As Jenna said, our chat is live, so please feel free to join us and comment in real time. Also, this is an archival film of The Open Door that you're about to see. And a film of one of Paul Taylor's dances is not the dance, it's like a 2D copy of the dance. So while it's not the same as seeing the dance in the theater, it's the best we can do, but we're still excited to share it with you. So without further ado, our program for tonight, I am very proud to connect us with famed costume designer William Ivey Long. William is a legend, having just designed his 75th Broadway show. He has been nominated for over a dozen Tony Awards, winning 6 times. You may know his work from Chicago, A Bronx Tale, the musical, Beetlejuice, On the 20th Century, Cabaret, Rodgers and Hammerstein's Cinderella, The Producers, The Boy from Oz, Hairspray, Crazy for You, Guys and Dolls, and Nine. He is a 5-time Drama Desk Award winner, was inducted into the American Theater Hall of Fame in 2005, and recently completed a 4-year elected term as chairman of the American Theater Wing. As part of this incredible career, he has also worked with Paul Taylor, designing 7 Taylor works, including Equinox, Byzantium, Roses, Kith and Kin, Danbury Mix, The Open Door, and Paul Taylor's last work, concertiana. Tonight, we'll hear some insights and conversation on collaborating with Paul Taylor, specifically on designing the set and costumes for Taylor's second to last work, The Open Door, which premiered in 2017, choreographed the music of Edward Elgar's Enigma Variations with lighting by James Ingalls. Then you'll get to see an archival film of this dance featuring the original cast. We are grateful for his time, passion, and insights to enrich your experience of the Taylor world. Hope you enjoy the program. It is a sincere pleasure to talk to you today, William. Part of what's going on right now in the universe is that we're trying to create ways to share stories, because I think stories are an important part to art making. And I think it gives a lot of insights to audiences, to aspiring artists and dancers and designers. And I wanted to focus on designers specifically because as a collective, without you, you know, the work wouldn't be what it is. So thank you.
Well, we add to it anyway. We're a support group.
Why I'm excited about this conversation is because you came into the company's history in the early 1980s. And before we get into that, I do want audiences to know, if they don't, that you have an utterly spectacular resume. Over 70 Broadway shows, you've been nominated for 15 Tony Awards. 18 Tony Awards. And you've won.
75. Beetlejuice was my Diamond Jubilee. That was my 75th. We had a big sort of silly party.
That's incredible. I want to start at the beginning. I want to start how you found stage design and costume design and where your journey kind of took you to that moment.
Oh, you mean not just Paul Taylor design?
I kind of want to give people how do we get to 1983? Because that was your first collaboration with
Paul. That's right. My first memory of dance was, believe it or not, modern dance down south. And the reason is my parents, the colleagues on the campus at Chapel Hill, University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, one of their best friends were the Fitzsimmons family. And Foster Fitzsimmons was one of the original, in the very original Dennis Shawn dance troupe and up at Jacob's Pillow. And I would watch classes that every now and then he would give classes, and I would be a little, not toddler, but I mean, I would be 8, and I would go see this. So it's quite unusual for the South to have so much modern dance, but we were very lucky because of this Foster Fitzsimmons connection. So I grew up watching this very muscular, masculine approach to storytelling through movement. Really what was touring for us to see was ballet. So I would go to concerts that would come to Chapel Hill and we'd all go and see it. And I was stricken immediately with awe and joy and gladness. But there was a more hands-on connection with modern dance, this particular, which was, of course, in my mind, totally different because of Foster Fitzsimmons.
How did you land a meeting with Paul?
Well, first of all, I have to just say, when I moved to New York City in 1975 from graduate school in New Haven, the word on the street in our crowd was Paul Taylor Dance Company, you have to go see it. So I started in the audience, of course. I would go, and you know, back then you could afford tickets to everything. Anyone could afford tickets. It's amazing how inflation does this. So I would sit like in the 10th row center at City Center and watch and go like 2 or 3 times a week. And it was just, and I was so astonished as an audience member. Now, mind you, this is before I knew the repertoire or anything. When I saw Esplanade, which is, you know, again, there you are. And it was so real. And the movements were real people, and how Paul had them move in human ways and jumping for joy and sliding and throwing themselves. I almost leapt out of my seat. I really remember almost leaping out of my seat when I saw them throw themselves on the floor and slide. And oh my goodness. So I was a goner. I said, okay, the Paul Taylor Dance Company, I mean, here we are. And years would go by. And then one of my dear friends from Yale Drama School, David Grobman, scenic designer, and his wife, scenic designer, Karen Grobman, they're great friends. Their oldest child is my goddaughter. So very close with them. And David would then, when he did Snow White, I think was the first thing David designed for Paul. I would go with him and to the tech rehearsals, sort of sneaking in backstage, you know, no one fortunately said, who's that weird person over there? I just was allowed in. So that brought me a little closer, still hadn't met Paul, just still circling. And David and Jennifer Tipton decided I should design for Paul. And so Jennifer introduced me to Paul, just like that. Not David Grobman, Jennifer Tipton. So I started, you know, with the longtime collaborator introducing me into the bosom. And so as with Paul's every meeting with me, he didn't want to look at sketches or portfolio. He just said, come and sit by me and see what you think. Which of course is heady stuff for a youngster. Because with directors on the Broadway, they're gonna tell you they're gonna go person by person and scene by scene and tell you exactly what they want. Or at least they'll say, show me environments, bring it to me and I'll pick. There are many different ways that directors work. And this is before I had started working with so many director choreographers like Tommy Toon and Susan Stroman.
Yeah.
And Paul helped prepare me for that because I knew I would be asked to bring a lot to it because words, you know, are not many choreographers' main means of communication. In fact, not. Mm-hmm. Words are not, like Paul would say to shut me up, they're just steps when I was trying to, get inside and dissect what this movement is and how you want them to look. Paul used to tell me, and I'm jumping a bit, that one of the favorite things he would do with me is we would talk about different gestures, like an arm movement, a shoulder movement, Cloven Kingdom, where does that go back to? And he said, you can watch it if you look at, you know, Dennis and Ted Shawn. If you watch Ted Shawn's work with his all-male group, you can see certain gestures. Now, granted, for me, they're in photographs. They're not moving. Mm-hmm. And he says, you can trace it there. You can trace it to Eric Hawkins, Martha Graham, then Paul Taylor, and then Dan Wagner, then Twyla Tharp, then David Parsons. And he said, what is exciting is to discover this history and this passing on, each one teach one. You know, the vocabulary is passed down and burnished and changed. Mm-hmm. But if you look carefully, you can see it going all the way back.
He was so big on gesture. I mean, it was honestly, especially towards the last couple of years, and we're going to get to the open door, which I'm really excited about. But it's almost a study of gesture and how gestures translate to characters and archetypes. But we often say in the repertory that, you know, the origin of dance steps is gestural. It's emotional, that there's an emotional thought to something. And it changes how you perform it. And I would imagine it changes how you design for it as well.
Because
yes. Of how the body moves, you know, if you've worn a suit or a regular dress, the amount of work that actually goes into making a suit for dance or a dress for dance, it's a completely different construction process.
Totally. And for instance, the one I made for you, for the open door. And I would say, okay, raise your arm. And I think I was wearing a blazer at the time because that's my uniform. Yeah. I was wearing a blazer and I said, look, you can't dance in this blazer.
Because this is a regular,
the shoulder pad went right into my ear, just like yours is doing.
Yeah, if you do this, see, like it's audience going, is we're, tuning we're, in.
Lift
you
it all
this,
the way up.
Like,
see, hit your this, ear. That's
this
not
is,
pretty.
It's not pretty. So
Paul would like that. in certain ways.
I think costumes inform artistic choices, like dancers' choices. And I think Paul knew that what you wear can create confidence. It can create character. It can bind you and hold you back. And I think there's something with that. If those costumes were too dancey, it actually might affect the movement to the point that it didn't look human. Costumes, again, you know, help the stature. They help the gesture. And I think what's great about the open door as audiences watch it is that you'll see how every dancer, the gestures may have been there before they tried on all of the costumes, but certainly when everyone was in their costume, the character and the gestures and the impulses and the reactions became even further cemented.
Wow.
Costumes, I think, change how you perform. If you feel good in your costume, if you feel that the costume's character is solid, you as the wearer of that costume will take that on to the next step.
Wow.
Laura Halzack, as an example, you made this beautiful, large costume for Laura Halzack, and she would rehearse in the studio with pillows kind of strapped, particularly when she falls down, you know, to get a sense of what it's like to move with, you know, all that accoutrement.
Right.
But I know for a fact that you two had quite a fun time.
We
assembling
did.
That costume.
We did. And she was very much a part of that process. Well, I find the people on whom you make a look, create a look, are partners in the making of the look. It's not just here, wear this at all. And one of the reasons I enjoy working on Chicago so much, because I get to reinterpret one of our now 22 years classic looks, and I get to change it for that performer, not for everybody, but just for Roxy. And it gives me a joy to find out that in any fitting is, what do you think? I also say no tears after a fitting, only smiles after a fitting. So if something isn't working, I have to change it on the spot. Mm-hmm. And I do.
I think what's interesting about when you look at the seven dances that you've designed for within our repertory, there's an incredible spectrum there of styles of costuming. In 2017, Paul Taylor started creating The Open Door, which was his second to last piece. And this time you designed the sets as well as the costume. And Paul cast dancers each as characters. And I'm hosting a party, and one by one, every character comes in. And as we watch this, I want audiences to look at how incredibly different and detailed and beautiful every single costume is. And it's just like you're-
And he gave me very specific, I have paragraphs underneath the sketches of what he typed up and sent me. It was he had a vision.
He had a vision.
Totally in his mind. And I'll never forget the phone call. He says, it's a story and they're real people, and they all have a story to tell.
When you're inside the process of making a work, you know, you don't have that outside perspective. And Paul gave us very specific characters. I remember distinctly sitting on the floor around him. He had your sketches, which had your notes that he gave you about, you know, this is a host.
I had him on the bottom, yeah.
By the bottom, yeah. Like, you know. And he gave us these archetypes, and that was, it was kind of it. He let us create the dance from there. What relationship we all had to each other, we were never told. And the sequence in which people enter,
yes,
is fascinating, because it wasn't intentional. It kind of randomly happened in a certain order. But wow. Audiences have turned this work as they watch it as like the host is Paul. These are different archetypes of his life.
Of his life.
That he's hosting.
When I caught on to that, I burst into tears at home. Yeah. When I realized that Paul was showcasing various parts of his personality and his history. Yeah. I just collapsed. I'm tearing up right now.
Yeah. And I don't think
any of us— Because it was unspoken. Yeah. He didn't tell me that.
He didn't
I
tell
had
us.
To discover yeah. it by watching it.
Yeah.
Oh my. And that is when I started putting it together that, oh, Paul is, this is his farewell.
Yeah.
Oh, it's heartbreaking to discover this. I really collapsed. And every time I watch it, I tear up. It's just, I'm sure you all do too.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for your time and all these wonderful stories.
Thanks for including me.
Of course. I love him so much. We had so much fun together. I really hope audiences, I hope tuning in that you really enjoyed that experience. Not just hearing from William Ivey Long and watching The Open Door, but also watching this particular work with the lens of understanding what love went into designing it. It's a wonderful opportunity to see work that way. So thank you. We also wanted to let you know that earlier in the conversation, we did show sketches of William's designs for The Open Door. We only showed three of them, but we want to show you all of them actually. So stay tuned at the end of our presentation and we will actually reveal all of them so you can enjoy those.
And our chat will remain live also for the next several minutes. So you can stay on there, connect with us, ask your questions. We look forward to hearing from you. And finally, just another special thank you to the DCA and our board of directors and board of advisors for their ongoing support.
Stay strong, stay healthy. Here's to 2021 and stay tuned for more incredible content coming from the Paul Taylor family to you. Thank you for your time.
Good night.